Chapter 63. The Storm Breaks. The first horizontal rays of dawn already streaked across the land when Triana said to Aragon, "It is time." A surge of energy erased Aragon's sleepiness. Jumping to his feet, he shouted the word to everyone around him, even as he clambered into Saphira's saddle, pulling his new bow from its quiver. The coal and dwarves surrounded Saphira, and together they hurried down the breastwork until they reached the opening that had been cleared during the night. The Varden poured through the gap, quiet as they could be. Rank upon rank of warriors marched past, their armor and weapons padded with rags so no sound would alert the Empire of their approach. Saphira joined the procession when Nasueda appeared on a roan charger in the midst of the men, Arya and Triana by her side. The five of them acknowledged each other with a quick glance, nothing more. During the night, the mephitic vapors had accumulated low to the ground, and now the dim morning light gilded the turgid clouds, turning them opaque. Thus, the Varden managed to cross three-quarters of the No Man's Land before they were seen by the Empire's sentries. As the alarm horns rang out before them, Nasueda shouted, "Now, Aragon! Tell Orin to strike! To me, men of the Varden! Fight to win back your homes! Fight to guard your wives and children! Fight to overthrow Galbatorix! Attack and bathe your blades in the blood of our enemies! Charge!" She spurred her horse forward, and with a great bellow, the men followed, shaking their weapons above their heads. Aragon conveyed Nasueda's orders to Bardon, the spellcaster who rode with King Orin. A moment later, he heard the drumming of hooves as Orin and his cavalry, accompanied by the rest of the Coal, who could run as fast as horses, galloped out of the east. They charged into the Empire's flank, pinning the soldiers against the Jet River and distracting them long enough for the Varden to cross the remainder of the distance between them without opposition. The two armies collided with a deafening roar. Pikes clashed against spears, hammers against shields, swords against helms, and above it all whirled the hungry gore crows uttering their harsh croaks, driven into a frenzy by the smell of fresh meat below. Aragon's heart leaped within his chest. "I must now kill or be killed." Almost immediately, he felt his wards drawing upon his strength as they deflected attacks from Arya, Oryk, Nasueda, and Saphira. Saphira held back from the leading edge of the battle, for they would be too exposed to Galbatorix's magicians at the front. Taking a deep breath, Aragon began to search for those magicians with his mind, firing arrows all the while. Duvangargata found the first enemy spellcaster. The instant he was alerted, Aragon reached out to the woman who made the discovery, and from there to the foe she grappled with. Bringing the full power of his will to bear, Aragon demolished the magician's resistance, took control of his consciousness, doing his best to ignore the man's terror, determined which troops the man was guarding, and slew the man with one of the 12 words of death. Without pause, Aragon located the minds of each of the now unprotected soldiers and killed them as well. The Varden cheered as the knot of men went limp. The ease with which he slew them amazed Aragon. The soldiers had had no chance to fight back or escape. How different from Farthendur, he thought. Though he marveled at the perfection of his skills, the deaths sickened him, but there was no time to dwell on it. Recovering from the Varden's initial assault, the Empire began to man their engines of war, catapults that cast round missiles of hard-baked ceramic, trebuchets armed with barrels of liquid fire, and ballistae that bombarded the attackers with a hail of arrows 6 feet long. The ceramic balls and the liquid fire caused terrific damage when they landed. One ball exploded against the ground not 10 yards from Saphira. As Aragon ducked behind his shield, a jagged fragment spun toward his head, only to be stopped dead in the air by one of his wards. He blinked at the sudden loss of energy. The engines soon stalled the Varden's advance, sowing mayhem wherever they aimed. "They have to be destroyed if we're going to last long enough to wear down the Empire," realized Aragon. It would be easy for Saphira to dismantle the machines, but she dared not fly among the soldiers for fear of an attack by magic. Breaking through the Varden lines, 8 soldiers stormed toward Saphira, jabbing at her with pikes. Before Aragon could draw Zarok, the dwarves and Coal eliminated the entire group.
"A good fight!"
roared Garsfog.
A good fight,
agreed Oryk with a bloody grin. Aragorn did not use spells against the engines. They would be protected against any conceivable enchantment. Unless... Extending himself, he found the mind of a soldier who was tending one of the catapults.
Though he was sure the soldier was defended by some magician, Aragorn was able to gain dominance over him and direct his actions from afar. He guided the man up to the weapon, which was being loaded, and then had him use his sword to hack at the skein of twisted rope that powered the machine. The rope was too thick to sever before the soldier was dragged away by his comrades, but the damage was already done. With a mighty crack, the partially wound skein broke, sending the arm of the catapult flying backward and injuring several men.
His lips curled in a grim smile. Aragorn proceeded to the next catapult, and in short order, disabled the remainder of the engines. Returning to himself, Aragorn became aware of the dozens of the Varden collapsing around Saphira. One of Duvangargata had been overwhelmed. He uttered a dreadful curse and flung himself back along the trail of magic as he searched for the man who cast the fatal spell, entrusting the welfare of his body to Saphira and his guards. For over an hour, Aragorn hunted Galbatorix's magicians, but to little avail, for they were wily and cunning and did not directly attack him. Their reticence puzzled Aragorn, until he tore from the mind of one of the spellcasters, moments before he committed suicide. The thought, "Ordered not to kill you or the dragon, not to kill you or the dragon." "Well, that answers that my question," he said to Saphira. "But why does Galbatorix still want us alive? We've made it clear we support the Varden." Before she could respond, Nasweda appeared before them, her face streaked with filth and gore, her shield covered with dents, blood sheeting down her left leg from a wound on her thigh. "Aragorn," she gasped, "I need you, both of you, to fight, to show yourselves and embolden the men, to frighten the soldiers." Her condition shocked Aragorn. "Let me heal you first," he cried, afraid she might faint. "I should have put more wards about her." "No, I can wait, but we are lost unless you stem the tide of soldiers." Her eyes were glazed and empty, blank holes in her face. "We need a rider." She swayed in her saddle. Aragorn saluted her with Zarak.
"You have one, my lady."
"Go," she said, "and may what gods there are watch over you." Aragorn was too high on Saphira's back to strike his enemies below, so he dismounted and positioned himself by her right paw. To Oryk and Garsfog, he said,
"Protect Saphira's left side, and whatever you do, don't get in our way." "It will be overrun, Fire Sword."
"No," said Aragorn, "I won't. Now take your places." As they did, he put his hand on Saphira's leg and looked at her in one clear-cut sapphire eye. "Shall we dance, friend of my heart?"
"We shall, little one."
Then he and she merged their identities to a greater degree than ever before, vanquishing all differences between them to become a single entity. They bellowed, leaped forward, and forged a path to the front line. Once there, Aragorn could not tell from whose mouth emanated the ravenous jet of flame that consumed a dozen soldiers, cooking them in their mail, nor whose arm it was that brought Zarak down in an arc, cleaving a soldier's helm in half. The metallic scent of blood clogged the air, and curtains of smoke wafted over the burning plains, alternately concealing and revealing the clumps, knots, ranks, and battalions of thrashing bodies. Overhead, the carrion birds waited for their meal, and the sun climbed in the firmament toward noon. From the minds of those around them, Aragorn and Saphira caught glimpses of how they appeared. Saphira was always noticed first, a great ravening creature with claws and fangs dyed red, who slew all in her path with swipes of her paws and lashes of her tail, and with billowing waves of flame that engulfed entire platoons of soldiers. Her brilliant scales glittered like stars and nearly blinded her foes with their reflected light. Next, they saw Aragorn running alongside Saphira. He moved faster than the soldiers could react, and with strength beyond men, splintered shields with a single blow, rent armor, and clove the swords of those who opposed him. Shot and dart cast at him fell to the pestilent ground 10 feet away, stopped by his wards. It was harder for Aragorn, and, by extension, Saphira, to fight his own race than it had been to fight the Urgals in Farthendur. Every time he saw a frightened face
or looked into a soldier's mind, he thought, "This could be me." But he and Saphira could afford no mercy. If a soldier stood before them, he died. 3 times they sallied forth, and 3 times Aragorn and Saphira slew every man in the Empire's first few ranks before retreating to the main body of the Varden to avoid being surrounded. By the end of their last attack, Aragorn had to reduce or eliminate certain wards around Arya, Oryk, Nasweda, Saphira, and himself in order to keep the spells from exhausting him too quickly. For though his strength was great, so too were the demands of battle. "Ready?" he asked Saphira after a brief respite. She growled in affirmative. A cloud of arrows whistled toward Aragorn the instant he dove back into combat. Fast as an elf, he dodged the bulk of them, since his magic no longer protected him from such missiles, caught 12 on his shield, and stumbled as one struck his belly and one his side. Neither shaft pierced his armor, but they knocked the wind out of him and left bruises the size of apples. "Don't stop. You've dealt with worse pain than this before," he told himself. Rushing a cluster of 8 soldiers, Aragorn darted from one to the next, knocking aside their pikes and jabbing Zarak like a deadly bolt of lightning. The fighting had dulled his reflexes, though, and one soldier managed to drive his pike through Aragorn's hauberk, slicing his left tricep. The soldiers cringed as Saphira roared. Aragorn took advantage of the distraction to fortify himself with energy stored in the ruby in Zarak's pommel, and then to kill the remaining 3 soldiers. Sweeping her tail over him, Saphira knocked a score of men out of his way. In the lull that followed, Aragorn looked over his throbbing arm and said, "Wazahil." He also healed his bruises, relying upon Zarak's ruby, as well as the diamonds in the belt of Bloth the Wise. Then the 2 of them pressed onward. Aragorn and Saphira choked the burning plains with mountains of their enemies, and yet the Empire never faltered or fell back. For every man they killed, another stepped forward to take his place. A sense of hopelessness engulfed Aragorn as the mass of soldiers gradually forced the Varden to retreat toward their own camp. He saw his despair mirrored in the faces of Nasweda, Arya, King Orin, and even Angela when he passed them in battle. "All our training, and we still can't stop the Empire," raged Aragorn. "There are just too many soldiers. We can't keep this up forever, and Zarak and the belt are almost depleted." "You can draw energy from your surroundings if you have to." "I won't, not unless I kill another of Galbatorix's magicians and can take it from the soldiers. Otherwise, I'll just be hurting the rest of the Varden, since there are no plants or animals here I can use to support us." As the long hours dragged by, Aragorn grew sore and weary, and, stripped of his many arcane defenses, accumulated dozens of minor injuries. His left arm went numb from the countless blows that hammered his mangled shield. A scratch on his forehead kept blinding him with rivulets of hot, sweat-mixed blood. He thought one of his fingers might be broken. Saphira fared no better. The soldier's armor tore the inside of her mouth. Dozens of swords and arrows cut her unprotected wings, and a javelin punctured one of her own plates of armor, wounding her in the shoulder. Aragorn saw the spear coming and tried to deflect it with a spell, but was too slow. Whenever Saphira moved, she splattered the ground with hundreds of drops of blood. Beside them, 3 of Oryk's warriors fell, and 2 of the Khol. And the sun began its descent toward evening. As Aragorn and Saphira prepared for their 7th and final assault, a trumpet sounded in the east, loud and clear, and King Orin shouted, "The dwarves are here! The dwarves are here!" "Dwarves?" Aragorn blinked and glanced around, confused. He saw nothing but soldiers. Then a jolt of excitement raced through him as he understood. "The dwarves!" He climbed onto Saphira, and she jumped into the air, hanging for a moment on her tattered wings as they surveyed the battlefield. It was true. A great host marched out of the east toward the burning plains. At its head strode King Hrothgar, clad in gold mail, his jeweled helm upon his brow, and Volund, his ancient warhammer, gripped in his iron fist. The dwarf king raised Volund in greeting when he saw Aragorn and Saphira. Aragorn howled at the top of his lungs and returned the gesture, brandishing Zarak in the air. A surge of renewed vigor made him forget his wounds and feel fierce and determined again. Saphira added her voice to his, and the Varden looked to her with hope, while the Empire's soldiers hesitated with fear.
"What did you see?"
cried Oryk, as Saphira dropped back to Earth.
"Is it Hrothgar? How many warriors did he bring?"
Ecstatic with relief, Aragorn stood in his stirrups and shouted,
"Take heart! King Hrothgar is here, and it looks like every single dwarf is behind him. We'll crush the Empire!"
After the men stopped cheering, he added,
"Now take your swords and remind these flea-bitten cowards why they should fear us. Charge!"
Just as Saphira leaped toward the soldiers, Aragorn heard a second cry, this one from the west.
"A ship! A ship is coming up the Jet River!"
"Blast it," he snarled. "We can't let a ship land if it's bringing reinforcements for the Empire." Contacting Triana, he said, "Tell Nosweta that Saphira and I will take care of this. We'll sink the ship if it's from Galbatorix."
"As you wish, Argilam," replied the sorceress.
Without hesitation, Saphira took flight, circling high over the trampled, smoking plain. As the relentless clamor of combat faded from his ears, Aragorn took a deep breath, feeling his mind clear. Below, he was surprised by how scattered both armies had become. The Empire and the Varden had disintegrated into a series of smaller groups contending with one another over the entire breadth and width of the burning plains. It was into this confused tumult that the dwarves inserted themselves, catching the Empire from the side, as Orin had done earlier with his cavalry. Aragorn lost sight of the battle when Saphira turned to her left and soared through the clouds in the direction of the Jet River. A gust of wind blew the peat smoke out of their way and unveiled a large three-masted ship riding upon the orange water, rowing against the current with two banks of oars. The ship was scarred and damaged and flew no colors to declare its allegiance. Nevertheless, Aragorn readied himself to destroy the vessel. As Saphira dove toward it, he lifted Zorak overhead and loosed his savage war cry.